Welcome to New Mountaintop Everywhere. I am so excited to share today's broadcast with you. I believe God is going to bless you in a very special way. Be sure to hit that share button, that thumbs up button. Helps us to get spread out so others can find us in the crowded algorithms of YouTube. Hey, make sure you're in the comments. I love to go back and read your comments as we fellowship virtually. There's no church anywhere like New Mountaintop. Get ready to be blessed by God's word today.
Good morning, giving all praises to God for this beautiful day that He has made. I am truly excited to welcome each of you to our Sunday morning service at the top. We celebrated Men's Day last Sunday and are truly grateful for all of our men who are also our heroes and the roles that they serve in our lives. However, the late poet Maya Angelou stated how important it is to celebrate our heroes and our sheroes. Therefore, we're so excited to celebrate women and our sheroes during this Women's History Month. I want to send a very special welcome and virtual hug to my sorors of the Douglas, Carroll, Paulding County's Alumni Chapter of Delta Sigma Theta Sorority Incorporated as we celebrate our Sisterhood Month by worshiping virtually with New Mountaintop Baptist Church today. As mothers, sisters, daughters, aunts, friends, and confidants, we are empowered so that we may continue to empower others. Again, we welcome you to our Sunday morning service at the top.
How many know there's something that happens when we begin to call on the name of Jesus? So help us call on that wonderful name.
We love to call your name. It's something explain that happens when we proclaim your great name. Your great name says,
we love to call your name.
We cannot explain that happens when we proclaim.
The witness that knows who the power is. Come on.
Say,
we love to
call your name.
Call your name.
We cannot explain.
Everything changes
when
we call your name. Say it again.
King Jesus.
No other name has more power than yours. Say, nobody's stronger. We can. So much power in your name, in your name, will you help me say?
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Oh,
power in the name.
There is power in your name.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Come on, so much power, y'all.
Power in
here we go.
Name.
It's easy to think that when we give, not much happens. That's because we tend to think of it as a single transaction. We give, they get. The end. But what if there is more to the story? What if God is doing more than we know with our gift? Good news. He is. When we give, we are doing more than we know, because God does more than we could imagine in three key ways. God works through us. We become a pipeline through which His blessings flow. Instead of holding tightly to what He has given us, we must let it overflow into the needy world around us, allowing God's glory to shine. God works with us. We become partners in His mission to renew and restore all things to Himself. Through our prayers, presence, gifts, service, and witness, we join in the gracious work He has already begun. We become co-creators, shaping His world for good. God works in us. We become participants in His work of grace within our own hearts. Our giving helps transform us, even as we bless others. And as we align our treasure with what He treasures, we reveal the work He is doing in our hearts to make us more like Jesus. What happens when we give? More than we could ever imagine. Give generously and discover what God can do because of you.
Glory. Hallelujah. Change it up.
You're the God of miracles, signs and wonders. We believe in Your power. We believe in Your power. You're the
God of miracles, signs and wonders. We believe in Your power.
We believe.
Say
You're the
God of miracles, signs and wonders. We believe in Your power.
We believe
in Your power.
Say You're the
God of miracles,
signs and wonders. Whatever you need, trust in Him. He's still working miracles.
You're a miracle worker.
Hey.
Come on, say it. You're the
God of miracles.
Lift your voice and say,
signs. Signs.
If you believe God, lift your voice.
We believe in Your power.
Confess it. Come on. Say,
come on.
We believe
He's still performing miracles. We believe
heal the sick.
You're a miracle worker.
And you raise the dead.
You're a miracle worker.
You're a miracle worker.
You're a miracle worker.
Somebody declare it over your life.
You're a miracle worker.
God is.
You're a miracle worker.
You're the God of
miracles,
signs and wonders. You're the God of
miracles,
signs and wonders. Come on, hey. I still believe. I still believe. I still believe. You're a miracle worker. Whatever you need. We serve a God that specializes in things, and He will do what no other power can do. Have you any river that sees the cross? And have you every mountain you just cannot get over? Hear what the doctor said. I still believe. I don't care what the symptoms are. I still believe. He's not a man that he should lie. And His word is true. And He will do. You're the God of miracles. You're the
God of miracles.
Come on, lift your voice.
Signs and wonders, we believe in your power.
If you believe it, lift your hands where you are.
In your power.
Say, you're the
God of miracles.
God, we trust you.
Signs and wonders.
God, we believe you.
Believe in your power.
God, we believe you.
Believe in your power.
Say, you're the
God.
Grace and peace, my dear friends. It's a joy to be with you yet again. And I look forward to the time that we're able to be together. And I pray that it's getting closer and closer as our world is vaccinated and as we continue to follow CDC guidelines. May God grant us the serenity we need to make those moves in order to get back to a place of normalcy in our nation. Good morning to everyone. I am so happy to have an opportunity to share the word of the Lord with you. I thank Lady Litman for the warm and beautiful heartfelt welcome to everyone as we celebrate women this month. And I also echo my beautiful wife in welcoming the DCP chapter of the Delta's sorority. Thank you, ladies, for joining us. Thank you for always partnering with New Mountaintop. And we pray that God will continue to bless you and your community efforts as you celebrate sisterhood this month. Well, everybody, it's so good to see you. Thank you for tuning in. Make sure you're in the comments. I hope you're catching my broadcast for TNT Tuesday Night Teaching every Tuesday at 7 p.m. And we're trying to be on both YouTube and Facebook now. Also, Wednesday in the Word every Wednesday at 7 p.m. right here on this YouTube channel. We're excited about what God is doing. And while we're waiting to see what God has next, we're continuing to move forward with ministry. Thank you for your faithfulness. Thank you for your love. Thank you for your kindness. Well, listen, go ahead and get your Bible or your favorite app, and we're going to go to the Old Testament book of Job today. I'm going to look at two passages from the book of Job, Job 13 and 15, and then Job 19 and verse 26. As you grab your sword, let me go before the Lord in a word of prayer. Father, thank you so much for what eyes have not seen, for what ears have not heard, and what has not even entered into the heart of man that you have in store for your children. God, continue to bless us, continue to move on our hearts, have your way in our lives. We give you all the praise, all the glory, and all the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, let me hear you say it. Amen and amen. Well, let's jump into this word for this weekend. I'm excited to preach this message to you. In Job chapter number 13 and verse 15, we find Job utter these words, "Though he slay me, yet will I trust in him, but I will maintain mine own ways before him." And then in Job chapter 19, verse number 26, we find Job stating these words, "And though after skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh shall I see God." This weekend, I want to tag this text, and I want you to put it in all of your social media with a hashtag, "Don't break down before your breakthrough." Let me say it again. Don't break down before your breakthrough. Well, ladies and gentlemen, a few years ago, I decided that I was going to learn how to swim. Now, mind you, I'm talking about just a few, maybe 3 to 4 years ago. Yet I did not decide to go and get a swim teacher to teach me in weekly lessons. I decided, as I often do, that I was going to teach myself how to do this, literally sink or swim. And so I went over to our local pool, and I decided one day I'm going to stay in this pool until I can learn how to maneuver this body through this water without drowning and actually be successful at swimming. You may not believe this, but when you have determination and when you have a resolve that I'm not going to quit, I don't care what happens, you'll be surprised at what you're able to do without the assistance of a whole lot of other people. Well, I taught myself how to swim. I was so excited, I didn't know what to do. Yet I felt like I was too old to go and tell somebody, you know. I felt like since I had the pool all to myself that day, that this was something I would love to stand on top of a mountain and yell out. So I did what I do. I came home and told my best friend, my wife about it, and my son. And they were so excited for me. I went back to the pool and I noticed that by the time I got midway the length of the pool, I was out of breath and I was ready to quit and to give up. And so I found myself in a repetitive cycle of swimming from one end to the mid-range of the pool. And by the time I got there, I was so exhausted and I could not figure out just how close I was to the other end, that I would stand up, look around, and be like, "Man, I just made it to the middle of the pool and I've got another half a pool to go before." I did not know how on earth I was going to make it from one end of the pool to the next end of the pool. So one day I decided, here's what I'm going to do. I know I have a habit of getting tired once I get to the middle of the pool. So the moment I get tired, that's the moment that I'm going to do my best and be even more fervent I'm going to breathe deeper. I'm going to hold my breath deeper. I'm going to swim that much more because I know once I'm at the middle of the pool, that's when I feel like giving up. Come here, lean in. I want to bless you. I discovered that when I pushed through the most difficult place, in other words, when I refused to break down, I could then experience my breakthrough. And I don't know who this message is for. Some of you who are looking at me right now, God wants you to know that you're closer to the end of your swimming pool than you've ever been before. In fact, when the pressure gets the most severe, that's the time to kick into your reserve faith. That's the time God is saying to you, hey, don't quit now. Keep kicking. Keep swimming. Keep breathing. Keep trusting, knowing that inside of you is everything you need to survive. But don't break down before you get your breakthrough. Well, listen, this story of Job is familiar to many of us. This story is about a man who literally goes from riches to rags, and then from rags to riches again. He is known in the Old Testament as the richest man that ever lived, perhaps next to Solomon. He lived in a place called Uz. He was God's choice, God's absolute selection. So much so that when God was meeting with his angels and the enemy, the devil, Satan, popped up at the meeting, he asked him, "Where have you been and what have you been looking for?" Satan replies to God. By the way, he always has to answer to God. Don't ever get it twisted. He can't do anything without God's permission. And Satan answers to God, "I've been going to and fro in the earth looking for someone to mess with." That's my paraphrase. God says to him, watch this, a sovereign recommendation. "Have you considered my servant Job? Have you checked out my boy Job? Have you looked at his life and his practices? Because there's none like him in the earth. He loves me. He fears me. He reveres me. And I have faith in him that even if he were to be tried by Satan himself firsthand, that his faith would bring him out. He will not break down, but he will have a breakthrough." And wouldn't it be wonderful if God could speak about us in that same way? If God could brag on us and boast on us to his arch enemy, Satan, and say, "I know that my daughter right there, I know that my son right there will not fail to serve me, that their faith won't fail them, but they will keep on going and they will make it through by having faith in me." Well, listen, this is how the story goes. Job goes through a series of madness. I mean, a series of trouble, a series of drama like you've never seen or heard of in your life. There's a series of things that began to happen in his life, yet his faith never, ever wavered in God. Job, number one, has ruined resources. He has ruined resources. In chapter number one, verse 14, 15, 16, and 17, you'll discover that Job lost all of his wealth. His cattle was killed. That was big industry for him. And 7,000 of this and 500 of that and 300 of that all gone at the drop of a hat. If ruined resources wasn't enough, then Job has removed relatives. Because in verse number 18, just as the fellow who came to report the loss of his finances was walking out, here comes another guy to report the loss of his family members. Because all of a sudden, a storm comes out of somewhere, not nowhere. Everything that happens in your life comes from somewhere. And all of a sudden, in one fatal instance, Job and his wife lose 7 sons and 3 daughters. You would think by now, with the loss of his finances and with these fatalities in his life, that Job would have been saying, "Hey, God, what's up? How on earth can you allow me to go through this?" But his response and his reply is still a response and a reply of faith and trust and hope in God. Job refused to break down before he got his breakthrough. Well, after he experiences ruined resources and removed relatives, Job chapter 2, verse 7 and 8 tells us that Satan wasn't finished. He comes back now to ask permission of God to literally touch Job's body. Well, God gives him permission, but he tells him, "You cannot have his soul." Wait a minute. That's a good place to shout right there on a Sunday morning while you sipping that Sanka or Folgers in your cup, to know that even though things will happen in your life that are beyond understanding, things will occur in your life that are beyond belief, things will happen in your life sometime and you're like, "What on earth is going on?" God will give the devil only a short chain. And God keeps the other end in his hand. And anytime he needs to, he can yank the devil's chain and gain ultimate control and victory over your situation. Is that something to shout about or what? Well, Job has this series of health issues. He has boils now all over his body. His body is broken out from head to toe. And he has restricted relief. He's already dealt with ruined resources. He's seen removed relatives. They've had 10 funerals, 10 hearse, 10 casket, 10 family flowers, 10 obituaries, 10 services. Now he's sick on top of all of that. And he has restricted relief. The only relief he has is that though he is not aware of it, God is protecting his soul. But his body is in bad condition. And he finds himself sitting out in a pile of ashes with ashes poured on top of his head, which was a sign of mourning and a sign of utter disbelief and shock, yet hope in God to do something about it. Job is sitting there and he is taking his wife's fine china, breaking it on rocks, taking the jagged edge of that china and literally scraping those boils, trying to find some relief from the condition that he's facing. Just when you would think things can't get any worse than that, Job deals with ruined resources. He's dealing with removed relatives. Job is facing restricted relief. Job now has rocky relationships. All he has left is his wife and a few little friends because his children have died. When you would think that there would be a word of comfort, consolation, or relief from his wife says to him, "Do you still trust in this God? Do you still maintain your integrity? Do you still trust a God who will let you go through all of this?" And not only did his wife come along and disrupt his peace. And listen, when the enemy can't get directly to you, he'll come through those who are closest to you. I see some witnesses in the comments right there. Not only did his wife create a rocky relationship, but he didn't have a lot of friends, but he has three or four friends who come to visit him. And when they get to the house, his wife just points that way as if to indicate, "I don't even want to talk to y'all about the situation." She points to the house and they go in and they see Job sitting there, perhaps in his bedroom, or maybe they met him in the front yard and he is literally naked with boils everywhere, breaking china on rocks, taking the jagged edges, trying to get some relief from the situation that he is facing. And these friends say nothing for 7 whole days. Once they do open their mouth, the only thing that they do say is accusatory statements to Job. Job, what did you do to tick God off? You know, some people need to stay away from folk who are going through because they don't know what to say. They are go and say the wrong thing at the wrong time and make the person feel worse about what they're going through. And be careful about putting your mouth on people, especially when you don't know the details and when you weren't there to see the whole story. He's got rocky relationships. He's dealing with ruined resources. He's got removed relatives. Job has restricted belief. He's got rocky relationships. By now, most of us would have packed up our spiritual bags and said, forget it all. Not Job. Job refused to break down because he still believed that God could give him a breakthrough. And listen to what he responds to his wife and to his friends and even to his situation. Not even knowing that God had competition, he had no knowledge that there was an evil or Satan or an evil one. And it's for that reason it is believed that Job was the first book of the Bible to ever have been written. Job replies with a resounding resolve, a resounding resolve in chapter 13, verse 15, though he slay me, and the he is referring to God, even though it feels like God is trying to kill me, is what Job said, though he slay me, yet will I trust in him. Even though it seems like God is trying to kill me, God has a grudge, God is trying to punish me, God is trying to take me out, God is through dealing with me, I still trust him. He says in chapter 19, verse 26, and after, don't miss this, after my skin has been destroyed, yet in my flesh I will see God. Now, this faith is just astonishing because Job has no Bible. He has no scriptures. He has no Old Testament. He does not have the writings of Paul in Thessalonians that talk about a new body or in Revelation that talk about a new heaven and earth. All he has is his faith. And I want to tell you that when you're going through the tough times of life, friends, faith is enough to pull you through. Don't you dare break down before you get your breakthrough. And here's why Job trusted God like he did. And here's why you need to not break down before your breakthrough. You ready? Here's point number one. Remember God's past performances. Remember God's past performances. This was not the first time God had done something in the life of Job. We only have this story in those 42 chapters, but this was not the first time God had brought Job through something or the first time Job had a trial or a tribulation. We know that because Job was the kind of father that would go and pray for his sons and daughters after they had had a party, you know, maybe had a few too many. Come on, talk to me in the comments. Job would literally send and sanctify his children, which meant that he would pray for his children. So he had seen God protect his children and keep his children from hurt, harm, and danger before. So this was not the first time that Job had seen God move. And I come to preach to somebody this morning to tell you that when you're about to break down, hey, before you break down, my brother or my sister, you got to remember God's past performances. What has God already done for you? What has God already brought you through? What has God already kept you through? Is your testimony this morning that he can keep you when you go through divorce? Is your testimony he can keep you when you lose a job? Is your testimony he can still feed you when your finances are flaky? Is your testimony God can take care of you even when your friends are fickle, fake, few, and phony? Is your testimony that you know about God's past experiences and past performances in your life? And Job says to us in Job 1 and 21, watch this, the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. So whatever happens in my life, blessed be the name of the Lord. And that ought to be your testimony. Based on your past performances with the Lord, you've seen some things come. You've seen some things go. You've seen money come. You've seen money go. You've seen people come that are friends today, and by nightfall, they are frenemies. You've seen things come and go and ebb and flow. And whatever has happened in your past, He has never failed to take care of you. Therefore, if you lose a house, He can give you another house. If you lose a job, He can give you another job. I ain't trying to start no stuff, won't be no stuff. But if a spouse walks away, you still got it. You can get another one. Because the Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Whatever happens, Job says, blessed, hallelujah to, praise be to the name of the Lord. And sometimes you have to just give God praise over what He's already done. You don't always have to see Him do something now to know that you can praise Him for what He already has done in your life. Is there anybody in the comment section, you my amen section this morning, the comment section is the amen section, that can say, Lord, thank you for what you've already done in my life. I won't break down because I know that you are the God of the breakthrough. Somebody type it in. He's the God of the breakthrough. Hallelujah. Listen, don't break down before the breakthrough because, number one, of His past performances. But then, number two, don't break down before the breakthrough because of His present protection. His present protection. Listen, do not allow the adversary to work your nerves to make you think that you're about to lose. You see, God has protected you, watch this, like the old church would say, from dangers seen and unseen. Listen, if you had a dollar for everything God shielded you from, hallelujah, if you had a dollar for every time God kept you. Sometime God didn't let things work out because He was protecting you from things you could not see. Some relationships had to break up because you thought it was Mr. Right or Miss Right, only to discover later it was Mr. or Miss Right now. God has a way of shielding and protecting and redirecting His children. And you have to remember His present protection in your life. Now, here it is. Here it is. God protected Job, and He protects us even now because He did not allow the adversary authorized access. Watch this, y'all. He didn't give Satan carte blanche, do whatever you want to do. He does not have a credit card without limits where he could do whatever he wanted to do to Job. Every time that he wanted to do something, he had to come back before God to get approval. Oh my goodness. Don't shout in your kitchen and tear up your refrigerator. Somebody on here ought to give him some praise because everything that has happened in your life up to this point has been authorized by God. Nothing just happens. The enemy does not have that kind of control, that kind of carte blanche in your life. If God allowed it, God approved it. Let me say that again for those of you who are praising Him at the house. If God allowed it, God approved it. Nothing can come in your life that God does not pre-approve first. And here's why. He won't put more on you than you're able to bear, which means that if you've got it on you, you can handle it. But watch this. When the load gets too heavy, God will either stop the hand of the enemy or step in under the load and carry you and your load together. Can I get a witness in here? You got to praise God and not break down before the breakthrough because not only of His past performance, but because of His present protection. Watch this, y'all. God plans the parameters of your problems. God does not permit more than you can fit. I said, God does not permit more than you can fit because He knows your load capacity. And he didn't let your condition become your conclusion. Listen to me. It may be a dark place you're at right now. It may be difficult. Maybe you've lost loved ones. Maybe you've buried friends in this year of coronavirus. Maybe you've lost income or a job or a significant other. But I just want to tell you something. I just want to preach hope into you right now. Thank God for his present protection, because watch this, in spite of all you have lost, pardon my bad grammar, but this is some good gospel, you ain't dead yet. Is there anybody in here, anybody out there? Hello, are you listening to me? You're not dead yet. And you know what that means? As long as you're pumping air, as long as you are breathing in oxygen, as long as you are pumping out carbon monoxide, there was a chance for a change. I said there was a chance for a change. I need my amen crew. Y'all ain't typing enough. Type it in. There's a chance for a change. That's why you can't break down before the breakthrough, because there's still a chance for a change. And Job had no knowledge of theology. He had no knowledge of angelology and any of those things. Yet he had faithology. Wait a minute. He had neology. I want to tell you, you need neology when you don't have theology. You got to be able to say, I still trust you, Lord. I don't see what you're doing. It doesn't make sense to me. It's hard out here. It's difficult. It's rough. It's tough. I'm crying and I'm tired of crying. I'm fighting and I'm tired of fighting. But through it all, though it feels like you're trying to kill me, I still trust in you. Don't break down before your breakthrough, number one, by remembering his past performances. Don't break down before your breakthrough, number two, by thanking him and remembering his present protection. But finally, don't break down before your breakthrough, because you remember the potential of his power. The potential of his power. This is so crazy. Watch this crazy faith Job has. He says to us in chapter 19, verse 26, and though after my skin worms destroy this body, yet in my flesh I shall see God. Wait a minute. Job literally has boils all over his body. Job is at the verge of death. Job has buried 10 kids. Job's own remaining few friends and his little wife are all antagonistic against him and attacking his faith. Job says, I know I'm close to death, but even if I die, and worms begin to eat up my body in the grave, somehow or another, the God I serve is going to wake me up, shake me up, get me up, put me back on my feet, and I'm still going to see him. Now, this makes no sense. This is a real theological conundrum. Because he has no knowledge of the afterlife. He has no knowledge of heaven and hell. He has no knowledge of a resurrection. He has no knowledge of a rapture. So he's talking about, in this body, God's going to deliver me. And you got to have that kind of crazy faith and remember the potential of his power. Listen, God's power is not limited by our realities. God's power is not limited by our resources. God's power is limitless. He can do what he wants to do. He's sovereign. He's in control. He is full of power, and he knows how to use his power to power you on through. I like riding on my boat every now and then, and sometimes I'll go out to the large lakes. The large lakes are different from the small ponds and rivers, because the small ponds are not always as deep. And then because they're not as big, they don't have the water power that can move you like this right here in a boat. And sometimes when I find myself coming up against strong winds and waves, I get a little anxious. And then I remember, hey, man, you got about 50 horses behind you. And so what I do is I'll throttle up and give it some gas. And when I give it some gas, my boat just powers right on through the waves as if the waves are just little bubbles in a bathtub. That's what faith does. When you trust God, even when you can't see Him, when you trust Him when you can't trace Him, and you give some gas to your faith, God will allow you to power right on through the winds and the waves and the storms that are trying to rock the boat of your life. God will give you the strength and the grace to power through. Well, that's chapter 2. But when you get to chapter 42, you see a different Job, a better Job. Because in chapter 2, he lost everything. In chapter 42, God gave him back everything. In chapter 2, he lost one of everything, but in chapter 42, he's got two of everything because God gave him double for his trouble. I want to tell somebody on my way out, listen, God will give you double for your trouble, but you got to believe God like Job did. You got to hang in there. You got to trust God. You got to be real with God, just like Job was. There was a moment when Job was trying to figure out where God was, and God showed up and asked him a question. Where were you when I created this whole entire world? Job ends by saying, "Now I know that my Redeemer lives." It took all of that for Job to be elevated in his faith. God will take you through some things sometime to let your faith be elevated. But listen, no matter what you face in your life, what you're facing in your world, power through it and let your faith navigate you through the winds and the waves and the storms of life. This story starts with Satan looking for somebody to mess with. It ends with Satan having to say, "I couldn't handle that." Well, listen, he's still looking for somebody to mess with. He might be messing with you right now. He's messing with me right now. But you know what? Let's power through in faith. And don't break down before the breakthrough. Come on, give God some praise, everybody. Hey, if you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, I want to pray with you and pray for you right now. Would you repeat these words after me? If you want to know Jesus, if you want to go to heaven, it's real simple. Lord Jesus, come into my heart. I admit that I'm a sinner. I believe you died for me. I confess you as my Lord and Savior. I will do your will. I repent of my sins. Fill me with your Holy Spirit, and I'll serve you the rest of my days. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, praise God. Listen, if you just prayed that prayer for the first time, welcome to the body of Christ. According to the book of Romans, chapter number 10, as you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God has raised Christ Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. Welcome to the body. You've got to let us know. Send me a message to our church website right there on the screen. I want to send you a gift to help you in your walk and help you get started on your spiritual journey. Well, thank you so much for tuning in today. God bless you, DCP, all of our precious members. I love you so much. Mwah! From me and Lady B and Alton, we love you. The grace of God be with you. May His favor always shine on you as you refuse to break down until you get your breakthrough. Peace and blessings to you.
I was young.